my colleagues of the Governing Council, members of the Institute of Marine Engineers, I hope some of you are from outside Chennai, speakers on the dais. Good morning to each one of you. It's a pleasure to be in Chennai. I try and visit here as often as I can. I've got some great friends here. And Anil, I don't know whether it's more or less vibrant than Mumbai, but Chennai is a happy place. So I'm happy to be here. We are at an interesting inflection point in the history of mankind. And I'm not using these words too loosely, but if historians record the 21st century in future, they would probably say that the progress that we have made in this century is equivalent to 200,000 years of earlier progress. That means the change is happening. It is happening at a pace which is so rapid. It is happening at a pace where most of mankind is unable to grapple with technology. And that leaves most of us feeling insecure, frightened, and in some cases, putting up resistance to change. Maybe it is time for us to pause and reflect. And I hope this seminar is one such occasion where we'll stop and think about how technology is affecting us. There are three major forces that are accelerating simultaneously. Technology or machines, globalization or the one big marketplace, and finally climate change. So cloud computing is possibly the mother of all technologies. We've now started referring to cloud computing as the supernova. So supernovas, as we know, are stellar explosions which release intense energy in a short burst of time and then fade away. The difference with this supernova is that it will continue to release increasing amounts of energy, and it looks like till infinity. It is this cloud computing that is now making asset integrity management possible from the comforts of your home or office. It is also going to drive autonomous shipping and autonomous ships. And so cloud computing now is touching almost every aspect of our life. Somebody remarked the other day that it appears that man is more hungry for bites, B-Y-T-E-S, than he is for a bite, B-I-T. And you can see the number of data centers that is springing up everywhere. Even your mobile phone today consumes an enormous amount of data. Just imagine what an autonomous ship would do. It is also the supernova that has made globalization possible. So we say that the world is one big market today. So when we talk of education, learning, trade, commerce, ideas, friends, religion, these are flows that are cruising across the globe. There are no boundaries, there are no restrictions. And so Facebook can connect you to somebody you'll never see, share your most passionate secrets. Globalization is here to stay. And so the downside, of course, is that if you eat a bat, a cat, or a rat in Wuhan, and you catch a virus, it's going to affect shipping here in India. It's also going to affect that little Chinese shop somewhere in Nagpur, whose sales suddenly fall. So that is the new reality. That is how we are going to see the world happening. Globalization means that if you have a spare room in your house in Chennai, you can easily rent it out to somebody in California. You don't need to be a hotel chain owner to become the largest hotel group in the world. So that's what globalization has done to us. The flip side, of course, is that the pirates, whether they're operating in the Malacca Straits or of Nigeria, or the jihadi, can now ply his trade with far greater efficiency. Again, something that's going to impact our lives. So globalization is here to stay. But in this period of globalization, or this era of globalization, how are we going to train and skill our people or reskill our people? So I've got the director of IMU here. We've got several other people, Sanjeev, who are engaged in training. But the thought process today is that do you really need a four-year course in engineering or in some of the basic sciences? Because by the time you get out of this course, what has been taught to you is no more relevant, it is almost obsolete. So do you now start replacing four-year courses with short two-month bursts? And do you keep reskilling through the year? How else do you grapple with technology? So maybe the session on training this later today will address some of these issues. But skilling and preparing people for this fast-changing world, this world of acceleration, is something of a great need. Which brings me to climate change. I think sometime in June 2015, Bandar Mahashar, a town, a small city in Iran, recorded a heat index of 76 degrees Celsius. Temperatures were 46 degrees, humidity was 90%, and it was the chill factor. The heat index tells you how warm you would feel in a similar simulated situation. 76 degrees is crazy. Today, climate speak is all about language like extreme, extreme temperature, extreme floods, extreme rainfall. When people talk of climate, they start saying that it used to be, but it's not anymore. We don't know what will happen tomorrow. We are alternating between floods and drought. See, water levels are higher than they were ever before. In the 4.6 billion year history of mankind, of this planet Earth, the last 12,000 years, nature has conspired to give us the most perfect climatic conditions for civilization to blossom. This period is commonly referred to as the Holocene period. Temperatures were stable, seawater levels were as low as they ever have been, so there was more ground area uncovered. It then supported man to move from caves, foraging in forests and hunting, to building a great civilization that we've done so far. But today we are pumping in more CO2 into the atmosphere. We are putting in more chemicals and plastic into the seas and the earth than we ever did before. And man is virtually pushing the Mother Earth, which is our only home that we know in this vast universe, out of this Holocene period. Sustainability, which is the underlying theme of today's seminar, hopefully should address some of these issues. Is climate change real? Is it time for us to stop and pause and reflect? Sulfur cap 2020, while we are protecting the atmosphere, are we now putting sulfur into the ocean and killing our marine life? Have we thought enough about it? Is there enough research to prove that the scrubbers that are putting in acids into the sea are really not harming our aquatic life? So these are some of the questions I hope the session today will address, or at least hope to address. But one thing is certain. We've entered an era where the world is accelerating at a pace which is frightening. It's also promising. And never before does man have such a big chance to influence the future generations as we have today. Gentlemen, please allow me another few minutes to speak about the Institute. Anil gave us a brief introduction to the IMEI. I took over as president from my batchmate, friend, colleague, Subha Rao, in October this year. But the IMEI is now aware that we need to adapt and embrace technology. We need to bring the IMEI to its members rather than the members coming to IMEI. And all of us here are focused on doing, on changing, on globalization, on cloud for the IMEI. So what we will hopefully do this year is we'll have the MER on a very friendly app. We hope the MER will be now available to even our seafarers out at sea. I think Dr. Raju Balaji, director of IMU and our editor, is driving that. We want to make membership a seamless process. Shankar sir here is driving that. We are in the midst of creating a digital library where we hope we would be able to access information as never before. And of course, underlying all this is our focus on imparting very high quality technical education to the marine fraternity. I don't know how many of you are aware, but the institute, with donors' help, has installed now what we consider one of the best engineering simulators in the world at the IMEI head office in Nerul. We want to replicate that at other centers. We want the IMEI to become, using technology, to become one of the best places in the country, in Asia, and in the world to carry out its objectives. It's a long journey. We've started it. We need as much support from all of you. I keep saying that the biggest strength of this institute is the committed membership that we have across the country. I think we need to draw upon this pool of experience for us to be able to achieve our goals. Gentlemen, have a great session today. I hope to see all of you in the evening. Jai.